Welcome to the paper of open source in the subject of information technology. This is the first module of open source technologies. In this module, we'll discuss what is source code, how source code is related to open source. We'll also study the definition of open source as given by OSI, that is Open Source Initiative. We'll also study what is free software, as in Free Software Foundation. Finally, we'll see how open source is being adopted in India and in abroad. So, let us begin with the definition of source code. As you know, programmers or developers, they write programs. The programs are executed over the computers. Now, these programs, the code that is written is known as source code. Either the source code is compiled or it can be interpreted. So, it depends on the programming language. For instance, if the programming is done in C, C++ or Java, usually we need to compile the programs. So, a program written by a programmer has to be compiled such that it executes in a system. So, certain languages like C, C++, they are all compiled languages, where the programmer has to write program and later on they have to compile those programs depending on the architecture of machine. Another idea is, instead of compiling, we can directly run the source code or the program. So, that is known as interpretation. In interpretation, the programmer will write a program. It can be either in HTML or shell scripting, and these codes, they can be interpreted or run by the interpreter. So, the best example is our web browser. It can be Mozilla Firefox, Internet Explorer. They all contain inbuilt interpreter. So, the HTML programs, they are loaded from the website, and these programs, when they come to the browser will interpret line by line. So, in case of HTML programs or scripts like JavaScript, shell scripts, there is no need of compiling those programs. They are simply interpreted by either the browser, or if it is shell script, it will be interpreted by the shell. In the subsequent modules, we'll discuss what is shell scripting, what is shell, and we'll spare few modules to learn shell scripting. So, let us come back to our discussion. When we write programs, the programs that are understandable by people like us, programmers or developers, such programs, they are known as source code. So, if I am writing a program for creating a calculator, it can be a simple arithmetic calculator with add, subtract, multiplication kind of operations. So, the program that I have written will become the source code. Once the source code is compiled, we generate object code, which can be executed on the system. If it is a scripting language, we interpret those programs. Now, the question is, if I want to give my program to someone else, there can be two ways. First, I can either give the object code. It means, whatever program I have written, after compiling the program, the output of that program can be handed over to some other person. It can be known as binary code or executable code. So, I am not giving the source code to any person. I am keeping the source code with me. I am just giving the executable program. Other way is, apart from executable program, I am also giving the source code. So, if I am releasing the source code, if I am showing the steps in the program, then the source code can be called open source. So, there can be two definitions. One is open source, other is closed source. Closed source means I am not releasing the source code. The source code is with me, and the executable can be with the users. They can run my program, but they cannot modify them because they don't have the source code. If the source code is released, users can modify the program as per their requirement, or they can also further distribute to someone else. So, in open source software, the software, that is the binary, as well as the source code, both of them can be shipped together. The reason why open source is becoming popular is, along with the object code, we are also providing source code. So, if the user feels he can modify that source code, he can customize that particular program. So, this is the reason why open source is taking up the market. In the coming modules, we will discuss different softwares that are used as open source software. We will focus on most widely used softwares. There are thousands of open source software, but the well-known software, Linux, is a very well-known software, which is widely used in schools, in colleges. And apart from Linux, there are derivations of Linux like Android. They are all open source software. As you know, such software, they are freely available. So, let us come back to our definition of open source. When we say open source, it means source code is available. Few myths which we have to take care is, open source does not mean it is freely available. Open source means the source code is available. So, it can be a paid software along with the source code. So, when we try to define open source, it is a vast definition. There are so many philosophies behind open source. When we say freeware, it says you are free to use, but there may not be open source. So, freeware need not be open source, and similarly, open source need not be freeware. There is another term related to open source, we call it free software. The term was coined by Free Software Foundation, Richard Stallman. He initiated the FSF movement. And when we say free software, it means freedom. When we say free, it is not on payment basis. Free is for freedom, freedom to use software. So, there are two foundations or two organizations. One is Open Source Initiative. They have tried to define open source software. The other is Free Software Foundation. They have their own definition of free software. The definitions are almost similar, but the philosophies are different. Open source, they insist on open source software, whereas Free Software Foundation, they insist on freedom. So, there are few philosophical variations. However, open source and free source can be combined together to call FOSS, FOSS. There is another term, FLOSS, FLOSS. The full form is Free Libre Open Source Software. So, it is a vast umbrella. When we say FLOSS, it contains freedom to use the software. It also contains open source software. You can use the software, you can use it freely, you can also give to someone else. That means, you can distribute to someone else. So, let us begin by defining open source. Now, as I said, OSI, that is Open Source Initiative, they have their own definition. Open Source Initiative, OSI, was founded by Eric Raymond in 1998. They have tried to define open source. It is a very generic definition, which includes 10 different points. So, let us begin the definition of open source point by point. Now, the first point says, open source software must be free distribution and free redistribution. As in the first point, when we say free redistribution, it means the license shall not restrict any party from selling or giving away the software as a component of an aggregate software distribution containing programs from several different sources. Here, there is a term license. Now, let us see what is license. As you know, any literary work is always copyright material. So, a student's assignment, teacher's lecture notes, they are all copyright material. Similarly, whenever a programmer writes program, he has the copyrights of that program. So, by default, whoever is the creator of a program has the copyrights of that program. Now, suppose if the program has to be given to someone else, there has to be a license. So, in open source, there are lots of licenses. In the coming module, we will see each license one by one. But when we are discussing free redistribution, it means whatever source code I have created can be redistributed freely. It means the licenses that I have can be propagated to other people. So, the first point is free redistribution. Second point is the program must include source code. So, whenever we provide a program, if it is open source program, it must include the source code and it must allow distribution in source code as well as compiled form. This means whatever software we are providing, we have to provide a compiled form as well as the source code. So, the second point of open source insists on providing the source code. The third point is derived works. This signifies that the license must allow modifications and derived works and must allow them to be distributed under the same terms as the license of the original software. So, the third definition says derived work must also contain license. Now, if I am using license A and if someone else modifies my source code, he must also use the same license if it is the derived work. When we say derived work means he has modified the actual source code. Usually, licenses can be classified into two large categories. One is copyleft license, the other is permissive. When we say copyleft, it means whatever license I have used and someone who is deriving the source code, he is modifying the source code, will have to use the same license. In permissive license, it can be possible that I am using license A and the person who is using derived work may use license B. So, this is about derived works. Now, let us move to the fourth point. It says integrity of the author's code or integrity of the author's source code. This signifies the license may restrict source code from being distributed in modified form only if the license allows the distribution of patch files with the source code for the purpose of modifying the program at build time. So, when you are distributing the source code, if there is a patch file, it can modify your source code. Usually, source code or open source software, they are being developed in incremental form. So, there will be version 1, 1.1, 1.2 and so on. There might be requirement of patch files in the intermediate versions. So, the fourth point insists on this patch files and it says the integrity of the author's source code must be there. The fifth point is there must be no discrimination against persons or groups. So, as per this point, the license must not discriminate against any person or group of persons. Let us take an example. When we talk about fifth point, I cannot say that this source code will be used only by the students or it will be used only by the management faculties. If I am providing open source, it has to be made available to each and every person. We cannot discriminate who is going to use, who is not going to use that software. The next point, that is the sixth point, is no discrimination against fields of endeavor. So, it says the license must not restrict anyone from making use of the program in a specific field of endeavor. So, as per this point, the software must not be restricted only for business purpose or only for scientific research purpose. If it is open source, it can be used by any person and any firm, any businesses. The seventh point says distribution of license. So, the focus of seventh point is on licenses. It says the rights attached to the program must apply to all to whom the program is redistributed without the need for execution of any additional license by those parties. So, if there is a license to a program, when we say source code, it can be set of programs. If there is an application, the license must be applied to the entire application, and the person or the group, whoever is using that license. So, the group, whoever is using the license, they can use a single license for the entire software. They can redistribute the software with using the same license. There is no need of using additional licenses. The next point is, that is the eighth point, it indicates license must not be specific to a product. So, according to this point, the rights attached to the program must not depend on the programs being part of a particular software distribution. So, the license and product, it can be independent. As per, according to this point, any license cannot be said that it is only for a particular XYZ product. Licenses can be applied to any product. It should be open source license. The next point says license must not restrict other software. So, the license must not place restrictions on other software that is distributed along with the licensed software. For example, the license must not insist that all other programs distributed on the same medium must be open source software. And finally, the 10th point indicates license must be technology neutral. So, it says that there is no provision of the license which may be predicated on any individual technology or style of interface. So, this is an annotated definition of open source. There are 10 different points. If we try to summarize the definition, it focuses on releasing of source code. Other point is it focuses on redistribution. It focuses on distribution using the same licenses, and it also says that any people, any group, any firm can use open source software. There is no restriction on persons, businesses, groups. There is no restriction that the software must be only for business or research. And finally, the open source software can be technology neutral. It should not emphasize that open source software must be used only with these particular technologies or this particular software platform. So, this is the detailed definition of open source definition, open source software as given by Open Source Initiative. The definitions are available in the website. You can go through the website. These definitions, they can keep on changing depending on the scenario. So, when we try to dig into more details of the definition, there are few other terms like warranty, patents, which we have to consider. So, there are set of licenses. Few license may not consider warranty, few licenses may not consider patents. So, in the extra reading notes, I have given a list of licenses and different links for each and every license. In the subsequent module, we will discuss more about licenses, but as we are defining open source software, licenses are always there which come into picture. Let us move ahead. So, this was about open source. Now, there is a similar term, that is free software. So, how open source is different from free software? and what are the philosophies behind free software. Let us spend few time on this particular topic. Now, the term free software was given by Richard Stallman. Richard Stallman, he started an initiative somewhere in 1983s, and he registered an organization, Free Software Foundation, somewhere in 1985. He insisted that whatever software was being provided must be free. Free means freedom. The Hindi word for freedom is mukta. This is the exact word of freedom. So, the software must be mukta, M-U-K-T. When we say free, it does not mean it must be chargeable or non-chargeable, but when we say free, free is for freedom. There is a similar term, libre, used in Spanish. So, different countries, they have their own terminology. Free can be libre, it can be mukta if it is India. So, the philosophy behind Free Software Foundation, there are four points which come into picture. So, there are four different freedoms when we are using free software. The freedom number 0, that is the first freedom, indicates freedom to run the program as you wish for any purpose. Second freedom is the freedom to study how the program works and change it so it does your computing as you wish. So, this indicates that access to the source code is a precondition for freedom number 2. The third freedom indicates freedom to redistribute copies so you can help others. And finally, the fourth freedom indicates freedom to distribute copies of your modified versions to others. By doing this, we can give the whole community a chance to benefit from our changes. So, in all these freedom, access to the source code is a precondition for each of the freedom. So, this is about free software. As we have discussed earlier, open source, if we try to define according to open source initiative, there are 10 points. If we try to define free software, there are 4 points. Most of the time, open source software, they are free software, but it may not be true always. Open source software can be provided on commercial basis as well. So, let us study few software. Let us try to classify whether it is open source, whether it is a proprietary or a commercial software. The most widely used software is Microsoft Windows. Microsoft Windows, it's a proprietary software. Source code is never provided to users. Only the executable part is provided, and they charge for providing Microsoft Windows. The same is applicable to Microsoft Office, MS Office, and its components like Word, Excel, PowerPoint. These softwares, they are not open source software. So, this is one revenue model. How Microsoft earns. Microsoft does not provide the source code, they are just providing the executables. So, there is no freedom in this. If a user wants to modify MS Word, he wants to change the style of menu, probably he may not be able to do this because source code is not provided. If you are given the source code, if he is a good programmer, he can do changes to particular software as he wishes. So, proprietary software, most of the time they are closed source, whereas when we say open source, we say the source code is provided to users. Now, few open source softwares which are being widely used, they are VLC Media Player. Probably all of us must be aware of VLC. VLC is a very good media player. It plays audio, video in different formats, and it is open source. Another open source software, we say LibreOffice or OpenOffice. These are the alternatives to Microsoft Office. these LibreOffice and OpenOffice, they are also open source. You can download them. You can download them free of cost. You can install them. You can redistribute them. And you can also modify the source code by downloading from internet. Few other widely used softwares, they can be GIMP, G-I-M-P. There is animation tool, Synfig. For audio processing, there is Audacity. If someone is working on servers, we have lot of open source servers. Apache web server is a widely used open source server. And most of the time, Apache open source server, they run on Linux. Linux is again an open source operating system. In subsequent modules, we'll study in detail how Linux works. We'll also study the different Linux commands and different programming utilities available with Linux. Linux in itself is a kind of foundation on which various open source softwares can run. Now, it is not required that open source software must always need an open source OS. For instance, Apache web server can also run on Windows. So, even though if we have a proprietary operating system, still open source software can run on proprietary systems. For instance, VLC Media Player, Audacity, these all are open source software which can run on Windows. So, there can be a mix of open source software and closed source software. Open source can run on closed source, and closed source can also run on open source software. For instance, we can install some closed source software on Linux also. One software which is widely used is Acrobat Reader. Now, Acrobat Reader is not open source. Acrobat Reader, they are not providing us the source code, but the software is freely available. So, we can say Acrobat Reader is a freeware. When we say freeware, it means we do not pay to get that software. You can download it freely, you can install it, and it will start working. But you won't get the source code of Acrobat Reader. So, this is a very good example where the software is freely available, but the source code is not available. Few other terms, when we say freeware, there is also something like shareware, trialware. So, usually shareware and trialware, they are all commercial software. They give you the software for some limited amount of time, or maybe some restricted features will be available. You can use that software, you can evaluate that software, and if you feel, you can purchase those software. So, the model behind shareware and trialware is you experiment with a software. If you are comfortable, you can purchase the entire software. Whereas freeware, they are free to use, but at some point they may not provide source code, or if it is a free software, you will get the software freely and you will also get the source code. So, these are the various categories of different software available. Now, one question will come in our mind. What is the revenue model behind open source? As in Microsoft, it is very clear that Microsoft is selling their product. They are not providing us with open source, or they are not providing us the source code. So, it is very clear that Microsoft earns lot of revenue by selling their software. But what about open source? Now, open source software, they have their own revenue model. In most of the cases, open source software, they provide support services, and that is how revenue can be generated. Let us take an example. Red Hat Linux, it is open source, but if some organization installs Red Hat Linux and they want support, means help, then they have to pay to Red Hat Enterprise. So, the company will provide them with the source code, and they will also provide services. So, if something goes wrong, if there is some problem, the company is there to solve their problem, for which they charge some amount. So when we say open source software, it does not mean that whoever is providing open source is at loss. They do earn some amount from open source software. Earlier, open source development was a hobby. Now it has been gradually being converted into businesses. If you read cases, there are lots of cases in which an open source might have converted into a commercial software. In some cases, commercial software might have converted into open source. A very good case that I would like to refer is MySQL. MySQL was an open source software, which is now become a commercial software. If you go through the case studies, there are a lot of case studies available. The first case was of Netscape Navigator. It was a browser which started the movement of open source. So, as of now, what we are using is Firefox. The roots of Mozilla Firefox, they lie in Netscape Navigator. So, I hope the case studies will be interesting to go through different case studies. Those who appreciate history, they can start from 60s, 70s, how hardwares were developed, how software was provided, and gradually how the open source and free software movement started. In the references, I have provided few references. You can go through the reading notes. You can refer those books. They are the classical textbooks of open source and free software. Most of the books can be downloaded from internet. I have provided links to certain books. You can download them. They are free to download and free to use. Another question that comes in a person's mind is, when we talk about open source, what are the benefits of using open source? There are a lot of benefits, but to summarize, we can concentrate on 3-4 different benefits. First is freedom. You can use the software anywhere, anytime, on any system. When we say freedom, we can compare with commercial software. For instance, if I am buying a commercial software, I can install only on my system. I cannot install on someone else's system because the license won't allow me to do that. If the software is in my name, I cannot install this software in someone else's computer. Even I cannot install on my friend's system. Whereas in open source, we have complete freedom. If it is free software, we have a lot of freedom. You can install it on any system. You can again modify and install it on any system. You can get it freely and you can also sell those software. So that is the freedom we are discussing. Other good benefit is there is no lock-in. When we say lock-in, it means if it is a proprietary software, we cannot do anything to that source code, whereas in free software, you can modify the free software as you wish. Third benefit is security. In most of the cases, it has been observed that open source software are more secure because lot of people, they are working on a particular project. So there are lot of experts. Lot of brains are applied to develop open source if it is a collaborative project. Most of the open source projects are collaborative. So, lot of people across the globe, they try to contribute to particular open source software. So, this is one more additional benefit, that is open source are secure. So, I would like you to refer to the extra reading notes. Go through the reference material, go through the websites of OSI, go through the website of Free Software Foundation. I hope you will enjoy reading the different cases, different definitions. There are lot of arguments because the philosophies are different. So you will find lot of arguments favoring open source, favoring proprietary software, lot of websites listing open source software, and a study of 1 hour will be quite sufficient to go through different open source software. A curious learner may go through n number of websites. You will come across thousands of open source if you spend time. So this is about open source software. Now let us take the scenario of India, where we are in terms of open source. When we talk about government of India, the government of India, they have set up their own policy of adoption of open source software. So each government department, they have to maintain particular policy to adopt open source software. State governments are gradually picking up open source movement. So most of the state governments, they are looking forward to develop their projects in open source. The main reason is, instead of using proprietary software, if they use open source, there are very less licensing issues. Because in proprietary software, a software can be used by say 10 people, 100 people. For each additional person, you have to pay to a particular company. Whereas in open source, there are no such licensing issues. N number of people can use open source product. So most of the state governments, gradually they are moving on to open source software, or at least they are building systems which use open source technologies. When we come to education, there are lot of boards, that is 10th, 12th standard, who have adopted open source. Ubuntu is a very famous software which is being used at various school levels. It is also being used in higher education. Surprisingly, higher education institutes like IITs and many other universities, they are now running open source clubs. So they meet up maybe monthly, bi-monthly, they discuss new software and how it can be used in particular education scenario. Now open source is not only limited to government and education, it also finds its place in businesses. Most of the businesses, instead of investing on proprietary software, they are also running using open source. So there is a combination known as LAMP, L-A-M-P, that is Linux, Apache, MySQL, PHP. Most of the web servers, they run on LAMP. Most of the websites, they are using LAMP as a software. So you can again go through various websites, you can go through initiatives that are taken in open source area. So I hope you enjoyed this discussion. To summarize, we started by defining open source. We tried to distinguish between open source and free software. We also discussed few software that are released as open source. We discussed few initiatives like schools, governments, they are taking up open source software. And finally, we also discussed the advantages of using open source. So with this, we end this module. I hope you enjoyed the discussion.